Okay, well, I want to welcome everybody to the service today. This is Christ Reformed Church, and I'm Pastor Ferguson. Amen?
Amen.
And you guys are the sheep of, my pastor. I'm not the great shepherd, that's the Lord Jesus. He's the great shepherd. Amen. I'm just an under-shepherd, is what I'm called. I'm underneath the Lord. Amen. There's only one good shepherd, ultimately good shepherd, and that's Christ. Amen. Okay. And so, as always, we go to God in a word of prayer before we get started, as we're going to be looking at the doctrine of the tulip in Reformed theology at the second letter, which is U. So last week we covered the letter T, which stands for total depravity, and this week we're going to look at unconditional election. Amen? That's the letter U. And if we make it through that, don't know if we will, we'll get to the letter P, which is the third letter in the word tulip. Amen? So, actually the third letter is L, it's not P, it's L, which stands for limited atonement. So P is another word for particular redemption, but we're going to look at the word limited atonement, since that's the proper letter of the acronym TULA. So let us go to God in a word of prayer, and then we'll begin. With every head bowed and eyes closed, will you pray with me? Our gracious, loving, everlasting Father, Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, Father of light and Father of love, we come unto you through the righteous blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, for all that you've done for us. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for taking our sins upon yourself. We pray and ask that you will bless this service today, that you will help us to learn more about you, that you will open our hearts and our minds to the truths of your word, that we will grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. We praise you and love you. Bless each and every person gathered under the voice of myself. And we pray that you will help us. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in thy name we pray, Lord. Amen. Okay, well, today we're looking at unconditional election. Last week we looked at total depravity. Total depravity. Just let me give you a quick recap. We're talking about salvation. And, well, Moses, he was a great leader, and he did lead the people out of Egypt into the promise, and not to the promised land, excuse me. He led them in the wilderness for 40 years. But total depravity, when it comes to salvation, every person born into this world is born into the world spiritually dead. You have to be born again by God the Holy Spirit. Amen. You have to be born again. And so it says concerning total depravity that because of the fall, man is unable of himself to savingly believe the gospel. The sinner is dead, blind, and deaf to the things of God. His heart is deceitful and desperately wicked or corrupt. His will is not free. He is captive and in bondage to his evil nature. Therefore, he will not, indeed, he cannot choose good, or he cannot choose God over evil in the spiritual realm. Consequently, it takes much more than the Spirit's assistance to bring a sinner to Christ. It takes regeneration. You remember we talked about regeneration last time? That means you are brought to life by God the Holy Spirit. Let me read to you a scripture from the book of Ephesians in chapter 2 and verse 1. And it says, "You hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sin." Verse 5 says the same thing. Even when we were dead in sin, God quickened us or made us alive together in Christ.
That's right.
By grace you are saved, and not by works. You remember what happened in the garden in chapter 2, verse 17 of Genesis. God said to Adam, "In the day that you eat of the forbidden fruit, of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt surely what?
Die.
Die." And Adam died, not physically, but spiritually that day, didn't he? He died spiritually. He didn't die physically for another 900 or so years. Amen. But he died spiritually, and that's why when he heard the voice of God walking through the garden, he hid himself. Now, if a living person were to hear the voice of God, he would not hide himself from God. He would run to God. Amen? That's precisely what happens when you get born again. You get brought to life by God the Holy Spirit. He brings you to life, and then you hear the voice of God walking in the garden, so to speak, and you believe. Amen? You hear the gospel. What's the gospel? Well, the gospel is Christ in one word. Christ is the gospel. The gospel means good news, right? Well, the good news is Christ. Amen? Aren't you glad Jesus Christ came to the earth? That's the good news, isn't it? It's not that Jesus was a baby and he dwelt in a manger, but Jesus was and is God Almighty, and he became a man, didn't he? He became a man, and he became the Lamb of God, the perfect Lamb of God. Now, if you read anything in the Old Testament about the sacrifices of the animals, the lambs and goats and bullocks, okay, they were to be without blemish. Without blemish. Okay? None of us in this room are without blemish. But Jesus was without blemish. Amen? That's what it takes to be the Lamb of God. You have to be without blemish. Now, the Bible says that he, or God, who began a good work in you, according to the book of Philippians, chapter 1, and verse 6, he who began a good work in you will perform it, or perfect it, until the day of Jesus Christ. This is saying that God is the beginner of your salvation. He is the author of your salvation. He begins your soul salvation. Okay? God makes you alive in Christ. God breathes his breath, the spirit of life, into your soul. You became a living soul to God, and you heard the gospel, the good news of Christ, and you believed it. Amen? And the belief, did you know even your faith is a gift from God, according to Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8 and 9, for by grace you are saved through faith. That the faith is not of yourself, it's a gift of God. Okay? Well, back to our study here on the total depravity. Consequently, it takes much more than the Spirit's assistance to bring a sinner to Christ. It takes regeneration. Jesus said in John chapter 6, "Unless the Father draw you, you cannot come unto me." Okay? Yeah, that's a pretty powerful words.
Day one now.
"Unless the Father draw you, you cannot come unto me." Okay? In chapter 6 of the Gospel of John, in verse 44, "No man can come unto me except the Father which hath sent me draw him." Okay? You must be drawn by God. You must be drawn by the Father unto the Son. Otherwise, you'll never come. Amen? Now, the word draw literally means to drag. So it's like dragging a dead person into a room. Okay, once you are dragged into God's house, then God breathes His breath of life in you, and you become a living soul unto God. A living Christian, so to speak. Okay? So you need to understand that, that unless the Lord build the house, they that build labor in vain. Psalm 127, verse 1. Now, it is the Spirit that quickens, it's the Spirit that gives life, it is the Spirit who gives us the new nature in Christ. If any man be in Christ, the book of Corinthians says, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, behold, all things have become new. Are all things new in your life? You have to ask yourself that question. Have I been made new by the Spirit of God? Am I a different person now than I used to be 5, 10, 15, 20 years ago when you first believed the gospel? Amen. You should be a different person. You should now be a person who loves the Word of God, who loves Jesus Christ, who loves the Holy Spirit. Faith is not something that man contributes to salvation, but is itself a gift of God. It is not man's gift to God, it's God's gift to man. Who created the world, man or God?
God.
Amen. Who created you, man or God?
God.
And who created your faith, man or God?
God.
Amen. Though it all comes from God, doesn't it? Every living thing comes and is created by God. And your faith is living, amen? It's a living thing, and therefore it must come from God. Every living thing comes from God. Amen? Okay, so now we've covered that point. Now we're moving on to the second letter of the acronym TULA. And it is the letter that's the letter U. It stands for unconditional election. Let me elaborate. God's choice of certain individuals unto salvation before the foundations of the world rested solely in His sovereign will. And let me back this up with Scripture. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4. According as He, the Father, hath chosen us in Him, in Christ, before the foundations of the world. We were chosen in Christ before we were the world was even created. Can you realize that? Before God created anything, He had already elected us to be Christians. He had already chosen us and placed us in Christ. Christ hadn't even came to the world yet. But God already had it planned out, didn't He? God already has a plan for your life. God has already written every day of your life. Did you realize that? God has written each and every day of your life. And we're just filling it out. We are simply fulfilling what God has ordained before the foundation of the world. Now thank God that He ordained us to salvation. Amen? Aren't you glad about that? Because if He hadn't, you'd be on your way to hell, wouldn't you? Well, God is sovereign and God is in control. Verse 5, Ephesians 1. having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. You say, why does a person get saved? Because God saw it fit. Because God is good. Because it's according to his good will, his good pleasure. Why doesn't he save all? Well, who says he has to save all? Who can argue with God? No one. Let me read to you Romans chapter 9, verse 18. Therefore he hath mercy on whom he will have mercy, and whom he will he hardeneth. The word hardeneth means he doesn't have mercy on. God is not obligated to save anyone. Amen? He doesn't have to save anyone. But aren't you glad he saved you? Because if he hadn't, we'd be on our way to hell, wouldn't we? Verse 19, thou wilt say then unto me, why doth he yet find fault? For who hath resisted his will? In other words, what Paul is saying, how can God charge me with sin when God is in control of everything? Who can resist his will? Well, God can charge you with sin because there is no sin in God. And God does not make you to, he does not cause you to sin. He allows you to sin. Understand? God is in control of all things, but he is not the author of sin. Okay? God, you see, this is getting kind of confusing. Well, let me see if I can clear it up. When God created man, okay, God put in him the ability to sin against himself. When God created the angels, like Lucifer, and he gave them the ability to turn against him, okay? The angels, like Lucifer. And Lucifer once was in heaven, amen, and he was cast out because he was, there was iniquity found in him. So there is no sin in God, but there is sin in his creatures. Now there's no sin in the animals, there's no sin in the birds, they're not sinners. No sin in guitars, there's only sin in man. Okay? Only you and I have sin in us. We are the only, and the fallen angels, they are sinners as well. They are sinners. They sinned. Lucifer, his name got changed from Lucifer to Satan, to the devil. No, the dinosaurs, they don't have sin in them either. Yes, God made them. He sure did.
Why did he make them?
Well, I guess he just wanted to. Who can argue with what God wants to make? So here's the deal. Nay, verse 20, but O man, who art thou that repliest against God? Shall a thing say to him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? Okay. Had not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor? Doesn't God have that right? God has that right, doesn't he? He can make one person to serve him, and he makes another person to hate him. Doesn't he? One to love him, Jacob have I loved, and Esau have I hated. This is what the Bible says in Romans chapter 9. It says, Jacob have I loved, and Esau have I hated. Verse 13. So those were brothers, weren't they? Jacob and Esau. Alright? Esau came out first. He was all red and hairy. He was robust. Because he was a man of the world. Right? He had strength and power. He was mighty. He was strong. But Jacob was a tender man. He wasn't like that. Jacob would run from a fight instead of stand and fight. Jacob, he wasn't interested in battle, in war. He just wanted to be left alone and take care of, you know, his little sheep that he had. But Esau was a man of war. And God made them both, but God says, I love Jacob, I hate Esau. But didn't you create him? Yes, I created him. Well, don't you, shouldn't you love him? Who says I have to love him? I have the right to hate even that which I create. Isn't that something? Remember what happened in Genesis chapter 6 when God flooded the whole world? God looked on the earth and said, man has become completely wicked. Brother John.
Yes.
You know what God did about that?
No.
He flooded the whole world.
Flooded?
Flooded.
Flooded.
With water. Until everything.
The Noah was on the earth.
Everything died.
The Noah was on the earth with the ark and the animals.
Except Noah and his 8 members of his family and his and the animals. Can you imagine that? All the people, all the animals, all the birds died. The only thing survived was the fish. Right? Only the fish survived. Everything else died. Well, God has the right to destroy his creation. He's going to destroy it again when he comes again, isn't he? Except this time it's not going to be with water. It's going to be with what?
Fire.
Thank you. Fire. God is going to burn the entire world up. But do you know what, brother man? God's going to create a new earth and a new sky. Yes, I hope it does. And that's where we're going to be with the Lord, the new earth. No sickness, no falling on your head, no breaking your leg, no doing any of that, because it's going to be a perfect world. And you and I will be perfect. No sin. No
pain,
hatred.
No problems.
No problems.
No pain.
No pain. No suffering.
Struggle.
No struggles.
No anxiety. We leave this world, we go to another world.
Yeah, that's right. No anxiety.
Yeah.
None of that. Well, we're going to be with the Lord. But it says here that his choice of particular sinners was not based on any foreseen response of obedience on their part, such as faith or repentance. In other words, what some churches teach is that God... Is that sun hurting your eyes, Brother Tom? Let me face this. I think Brother Tom... Is that better? Oh, that's the wrong one. Hang on. Let me get this one. Tom getting blinded over there. There, sorry, brother.
Are
you okay?
You need to pull this one in.
You want to pull that string there?
Yes.
You can. Pull that little string there. Pull it down. There you go. Thank you, brother John. Okay, so some denominations teach that God looks down the corridors of time and he says, oh, I see that person believes in me. That person had faith. I'm going to choose them. Does that make any sense? When that person cannot choose God without God making them alive? God does not choose you based upon looking down the corridors of time and seeing that you believed in him. Are you crazy? If God were to do that, we would all go to hell because nobody would believe in him. We're all dead. The dead person can't believe in God, can he? He's dead. If there's a dead person As the Bible says, in the day that you eat of it, you will surely what?
Die.
You're dead, my friend. If you're dead, you can't choose God. Understand that? God has to choose you. Like Jesus says, you did not choose me, I chose you. Isn't that what he said?
Yeah.
That's what he said. You did not choose me, I chose you. That should settle. I could just quit preaching and we could close the service right now. The Lord said it. Okay? That settles it. Not like the bumper sticker. You say, ever seen the bumper sticker? It says, God said it, I believe it, that settles it. Well, the problem with that is, God doesn't need your belief in order to settle it. Right? God said it, that settles it. It doesn't say in the beginning, God said, let there be light, and if you believe that, then God will make light. No. It says in the beginning, God said, let there be light, and there was light. Amen?
Right.
God's not sitting around, Brother Leroy, waiting on us to exercise saving faith in Christ. If he was, he'd be waiting a long time, wouldn't he, Brother Tom?
Yeah, he would.
Because no dead person can exercise saving faith in Christ. That's the whole issue. Okay? That's the whole issue. The Armenians say man is not dead. Man is still, he just got wounded by the fall. Well, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, Genesis 2:17, in the day you eat of it, you will die. It doesn't say you will be wounded, does it? It doesn't say your pride will be hurt. Alright? It says you're going to die spiritually. That's the whole issue right here. This is what separates the men from the boys, so to speak. From the mature, from the immature, right? You need to understand this doctrine of death, spiritual death. We died in Adam, didn't we? If Adam died, that means we died. That's what the Bible says. By one man, death came into the world. Okay? Death came into the world. And by one man, thanks be unto God, life come into the world through Christ. Amen. We died in Adam, but we live in Christ. Amen. We live in Christ. Man can do nothing of himself. Do you remember what Jesus said to Pontius Pilate? When Pontius Pilate, he was standing before Pontius Pilate, and Pontius Pilate says, do you not know that I have power to have you crucified or to deliver you? You remember what Jesus said to him? He looked up at him and said, you have no power over me unless my heavenly Father grant it unto you. Oh, how do you think that made old Pontius feel? That kind of crushed his pride, didn't it?
Yeah.
What do you mean I don't have any power unless your Father gives it unto me? That's what I said. Did I stutter? No. Because that's the truth. God is in 100% control, amen. God is sovereign. I'm so glad God is sovereign, aren't you? Otherwise, people could just break into your house and take everything you have and kill your family and kill you. If God wasn't sovereign, man, we'd be in some serious trouble, wouldn't we?
If you don't have God, God did not exist.
If God didn't exist, nothing would exist.
Yeah, it would be in trouble, wouldn't
it? This wouldn't be nothing. I mean, there would be nothing. If God did not exist, nothing. There'd be nothing, right? So we know God exists because all we have to do is look around. Because I exist, as René Descartes, he was a French philosopher. He said, cogito ergo sum. Say, what is that? Well, that's Latin And it says, I think, therefore I am. Cogito, I think, therefore, ergo, therefore, sum, I am. Therefore I exist. And I say, okay, yeah, I think, that I must exist, unlike the Unitarians, which say everything is an illusion, that nothing's real, that sin is not real, that I'm not real. I'm just an illusion. Isn't that enough to make you kind of dizzy? Well, that's a lie from the pits of hell. I am real. Okay? You are real. God is real. Amen? And this word, the Holy Bible, is real. And when God says it, that settles it. Amen? It doesn't matter whether you believe it or not. God says it, that settles it. Well, when God chooses you from before the foundations of the world, there ain't nothing that can stop you from coming to Christ. He's going to drag you to the Lord through every little nook and cranny of your life and your upbringing. He's going to say, Ed, you're coming. Whether you like it or not, I'm drawing you to myself. And you know what? None of us like being drawn to the Lord in the beginning, do we?
No, like being what?
It's not a comfortable thing being drawn unto the Lord.
That's right.
Because you usually have a lot of hardship, don't you? A lot of suffering happens.
I gotta go.
Okay, brother Ed. You usually have a lot of trials that come your way before the Lord saves you, don't you? I know in my own life I did. I was brought down to nothing. I was ready to kill myself. And my life was so miserable without Christ. You know that? I had tried everything the world had to offer. Money, pleasure, power, whatever little power I thought I had as a young man. You know, I wish I had some more of that strength nowadays, but God is in control. This is what happens, though. When God draws you to Himself, He breaks you down, doesn't He? He breaks your will. He breaks your pride. You know, I was reading this morning in my study in Leviticus, and this is just a little side note. Leviticus, of course, is the book on the offerings, or the Levites, where they get the word Leviticus. It has to do with all the different kinds of offerings, the burnt offerings, the sin offerings, the trespass offerings. Well, there was one offering that was called the meat offering, and the meat was standing for bread. Could have been called the bread offering. But they called bread back then meat, because bread was like meat to them. All right? Bread was the staple. Bread and oil were the two staple foods in the Old Testament times. That's all they had. If you had meat, real meat, like cow meat, you had some serious money. All right? Most people didn't. Most people just had bread. They lived off of bread, off of wheat and oil. And back then it would have been olive oil they would have used, because that's the common oil over there in that region. Well, it says in Leviticus 2:11, that no meat offering which ye shall bring unto the Lord shall be made with leaven. Okay? For ye shall burn no leaven nor any honey in any offering of the Lord made by fire. The leaven in the Old Testament is compared with pride and hypocrisy, for they swell like leaven. Pride and hypocrisy. They swell up, don't they? You know, leaven makes a bread swell, doesn't it? Like yeast, right? You got to put yeast in the flour if you want that flour to rise, right? Yeah. Well, pride and hypocrisy, they have a way of swelling up, don't they? You heard the saying, you got a big head. You know, big head Fred. He's full of pride, right? Full of pride and hypocrisy. Well, also, malice and wickedness is compared to leaven because they sour like leaven. Sour. They get mad. Right? You know, you ever met somebody who's really resentful? You know, they're just, man, you don't want to be around them. You're afraid if you say one wrong word, they're just going to pounce all over you. You know, they're going to hate you for the rest of their life. Maybe you have a family member like that. You know, you did one wrong thing, and at least they thought it was wrong, and then they hate you for the rest of their life. You know, you don't want to be like that. Because that's sour, right? That doesn't smell good.
What's that?
Being resentful is not a good thing.
Oh.
You always want to be forgiving, amen? Every day of your life, you want to forgive everyone. Don't hold grudges against anyone, right? Jesus says, unless you forgive your neighbor, then I'm not going to forgive you. That's some pretty serious words, isn't it? Yeah. Unless you forgive your neighbor, then I won't forgive you. Well, we know that whosoever is born of God forgives his neighbor. Why? Because he has the Spirit of God living in him. And the Spirit of God is the Spirit of forgiveness. Right? Spirit of love. You can't love somebody and not forgive them, can you? Say, I love you, but I don't forgive you. Is that love, Brother Tom?
No.
That's not love, is it? Say, I love you, John, but I don't forgive you. Is that love?
No.
No. Love is, I love you and therefore I forgive you. Right? If you can't forgive somebody, it just means you don't love them. Right? Well, God loves us not because he looked down the corridors of time and he saw that we loved him. What does 1 John say? 1 John says, we love him because he first loved us. Right? Yes, right. You would never love God unless God first loved you. Now, Jesus says, no greater love hath the man than this, that he lay his life down for his friends. Right? But did you know that we weren't even his friends? We were his enemies.
Jesus Christ.
We were the enemies of Christ.
Christ Jesus.
When we came into this world.
Yeah.
And Jesus, at the book of Romans, says, while we were yet enemies, Christ died for us. He died for the ungodly. Okay? He didn't die for saved people. He died for unsaved people. To make us saved. His death is what makes us saved. Amen. It's the death of Christ that saves us. We don't save ourselves. And then Christ comes and he says, now because you're saved, I'm going to die for you. That ain't how it works, is it, Brother Tom?
Yeah.
He said, no, because you're not saved and you need to be saved, I'm going to die for you. Right? That's how it works. But did you know a lot of people, they don't believe that? They say, I'm a good person. That's why Jesus died for me. Because I'm so good. I'm so good looking. I'm so smart. I'm so intelligent.
Oh, Jesus. No.
No, you were not so good looking. You were not so smart, and you were not so intelligent, because the Bible says, not many wise, not many noble. Right? Jesus says, I did not come to save the righteous, but who? The wicked, the unrighteous. Sinners. I didn't come to save the righteous. I came to save sick sinners. Not sick only, but dead. Dead. And unless the Lord build the house, do you know how much building's going to get done, Brother Tom? Unless the Lord build the house, how much? None. Right? None. You ain't going to lay a single stone down. Unless the Lord builds it, it ain't going to get built. Right? Yeah. He said, well, I built this house in my own hand. You didn't raise a single hammer and nail without the Lord giving you the strength to do it. And you can't do a single thing for God unless God does it in and through you. You understand that? The Bible says, in Him we live and move and have our being. And Jesus says in John 15:5, without me you can do some things. Is that what he said?
And do nothing without
nothing. Without me, you can't raise that hammer. You can't drive that nail. You cannot sit up in your chair. You cannot preach the gospel. You see how everything has to go through the Lord. Now, He's a mighty God, isn't He? He's in control, isn't He? And I love the Lord. I know you do too. We're just little peons, aren't we? And imagine how small we are. You think of how big the universe is. You look up in the star. You know some of those stars are bigger. It's like 10 times bigger than the sun. And look how small they look. Just because they're so far away. Why did God even make those? He didn't have to. He just did. Why did God make the moon? He wanted to give us a nightlight. Right? Isn't that nice of Him? He said, I'm going to give you a nightlight. You know, when you were younger, you always liked that nightlight, didn't you? You could see when you get up and go to the bathroom. You know, what's so scary in there, in the room? You know, you had a little night light. You know, why did God, He didn't have to make all the trees and the birds and the animals. He made them for Himself and for our enjoyment, didn't He? Well, on the contrary, God gives faith and repentance to each individual whom He selects. He selects. Okay, if I'm going to build a house, is the house going to tell me how to build it? Yeah. Is that brick going to say, now I want you to put me over here? No. I'm going to walk up to that brick and say, you look pretty good. I think you'll fit good right here. I'm going to pick it up. I'm going to put it there, mortar it up. It's going to stay there, right? I tell the brick what to do. Brick don't tell me what to do, right?
You know,
some people you think, man, bricks are smarter than that person. What do they call them? Stonehead or something like that. Rockhead. Because you can't think. You know what I'm talking about. You get my point? I can't tell God, now look, God, hey, I'm going to run my life this way whether you like it or not. No, it doesn't work that way with God, does it? God says, are you that foolish to think you can run your life the way you wanted to? Do you not know that I created the whole world and I created you? You're going to be the person I have created you to be, whether godly or ungodly. Why? Because God is sovereign. God is in control. See, there's no point in really arguing with God, is there? There's no point in saying, God, why me? Why'd you give me this life? It doesn't do no good, does it, Brother Tom? The best thing you can do is just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for choosing me. Thank you.
And praise Him, too.
And praise Him. That's a good sacrifice, isn't it? You know, in the temple, they always had the altar of incense burning. They'd never let that burn. That incense was always to be burning. Okay, that smelled good. Imagine you walk in the temple, you have all that incense burning, frankincense in there, and all the special herbs that they burn. It would have really maybe, you know, knocked some of us out. It would have been strong. But God says when you offer up the sacrifice of thanksgiving and praise, that smells good. As long as it's coming from a sincere heart, as long as your heart is with God, amen. As long as you do it for the Lord, then it's acceptable unto the Lord. Right? Jesus says, if you love me, you'll what? Keep my commandment. And you know how you prove your love to the Lord, Brother John? Is by being obedient to His Word. Amen. Obeying the Word of God.
Obeying and trusting Him.
Yes. That's how you prove your love. And when you want to do something good, like hand out tracts, or even, you know, anything, help somebody or pray, just praying. As long as you're doing it unto the Lord, then it's acceptable. But if you say, I'm just going to get down on my knees, I'm going to say my prayers because I know that's the thing to do, you're not doing it for the Lord, are you? That incense doesn't smell good to the Lord. You know, it says here in the book of Leviticus that it was a sweet savor, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord. You know what a sweet savor is? Well, a sweet savor is something that smells good. The Hebrew word nikoach means sweet or pleasant odor, from nuach, which means to rest. So when you smell something good, you remember smelling when you're younger some flowers or fresh cut grass. You like that? The smell of fresh cut grass. That smells good, doesn't it? The lawnmower guy driving by. Ooh, I'm going to open my window. That's fresh cut. Okay, that's what God, or when you do it for the Lord, when you obey God as unto the Lord, as if you're doing it to the Lord, then that smells good to the Lord. It's a sweet savor, an odor, a scent, a good scent. But when you do it out of selfish ego, pride, or ambition, then you know what it smells like to the Lord? The same thing it smells like in the bathroom, in the toilet, right? Doesn't smell good to Him, does it? When you don't do it as unto the Lord, it don't smell good to the Lord. Amen? It smells like dung. And you know as well as me, dung don't smell good, does it? How would you like a plate of dung for dinner? Who's going to eat that? It don't smell good. Now maybe if it if it smelled like, you know, grandma's Thanksgiving dinner, you might even eat it. It all depends on how it smells, doesn't it? You know. Well, these acts are the result, not the cause of God's choice. Okay, the reason you are saved is the result of God's choosing you. Not the cause. Okay? Not the cause. You're not saved because you believed. You're saved because God chose you to believe. Right? God made you to believe. God gave you the gift. And you know what? You cannot resist what God gives you. If God gives you health, you're going to be healthy, aren't you? If God gives you sickness, you're going to be sick, aren't you? Whatever God gives you, that's what you're going to get. And you can't argue with it, can you? There's nothing you can do about it. Right? God gave the children of Israel manna to eat in the wilderness, didn't he? And they didn't like it too very long, did they? They said, give us some real meat. We're tired of this bread wafer, this honey wafer stuff. We want some meat. And God said, do you want meat? Okay, I'll give it to you till it's running out your nose. How's that? How's that? You want some Golden Corral? I'll give it to you till you can't eat not a single more bite. They're going to have to roll you out on the stretcher. You say, oh, I love that Golden Corral. Well, you better not love it too much, huh? Because God might make you eat the whole buffet. All right? You might not make it out. Well, I don't mean to joke around, but this is the deal. You should be thankful with what God gives you, amen? Like the children of Israel, they weren't thankful. All right, they bickered, they moaned and murmured, didn't they? The children of Israel heard, oh, why'd you bring us out here? We had garlic and onions and leeks in Egypt, and we ain't got nothing but this little piece of bread that comes on the grass every morning. We're tired of it. You should have let us just die in Egypt. Matter of fact, they went 3 days out of Egypt, and then they ran out of water. Oh, what now? Moses, he had his hands full. You know, Moses was 80 years old when he went into Egypt to get the people out. 80. Aaron was 83. It wasn't like Moses on the TV. You know, he's a strong, young, 40-year-old man. No, he's 80, man. He went in there with a cane, you know. Hey, that's probably why Pharaoh didn't have him killed. He said, oh, this crazy old man, you know, just get him out of here. Just ignore him. He'll go away. He didn't go away, did he? Because God had a plan. Whatever God plans for your life, that's what's going to happen. You can argue, but it ain't going to do no good. Just talk to Job about that. Job can tell you, arguing with God don't do no good. You know what? Job ran his mouth for several chapters, 20-some chapters. Wow, why me? I shouldn't have been born. God said about 3 chapters, and Job shut his mouth up. And he says, now I know I have my foot in my mouth. I shouldn't have said it a word. I shouldn't have uttered a word. Did Jesus ever complain about his life?
Yes.
Did Jesus, did he ever strike back the people that were hitting him, punching him, spitting on him? Did he spit back at him? No. Jesus entrusted his life to the one who is in control. Amen. Jehovah. Even under the cross, Jesus never uttered one single complaint. Election, therefore, was not determined by or conditioned upon any virtuous quality or act foreseen of man. Those whom God sovereignly elected, he brings through the power of the Spirit to a willing acceptance of Christ, and all that is done by God. Thus, God's choice of the sinner, not the sinner's choice of Christ, is the ultimate cause of salvation. Right? Unless the Lord build the house, they that build labor in vain. Psalm 127, what? Unless the Lord watch over the city, they that watch, they're watching in vain, aren't they? It's like they're watching a soap opera, you know, and they're supposed to be watching for the enemies. You can't watch television and watch over the city at the same time, can you? Well, we think we can today. We drive around, got all these TVs in the cars, and you know, TVs for the children in the back seat. They're all glued to this entertainment. He said, "You know why? You know why our world is so evil, so wicked? Because people don't read the Bible. They don't. People hate God." You know what? I got these puppies.
They hate Jesus.
Yes, they do. I have these puppies, right? I've got 9 puppies. 9 in my house. Plus 3 adult dogs. I have 12 dogs right now. Well, I put an ad. I determined. I prayed about it. I said, I want these puppies to go to good Christian homes, right? I don't want them going to the wicked, where they'll be, you know, have to put up with all kinds of evil and wickedness. So I put up my ad in Craigslist, need good Christian homes. You know what? Then people started flagging my ad, and Craigslist removed my ad. Not once, not twice, 3 times. They kept removing it. Why? Because I put needs Christian home. Crazy. And this world, what is entertainment? Entertainment is just indulging the flesh, isn't it? When you can be spending your time doing what? Reading the Bible, right?
Yeah, should.
Yeah. Oh, billions and billions. Entertainment, multi-billion-dollar industry. You want to be rich? Just entertain the people. That's what all sports are about, entertainment. That's all sports is, entertainment. Movies, entertainment. TV, entertainment. God says, how about entertaining yourself with my word? Would you like to entertain yourself with God's word?
Yes, I would. Yeah.
Amen. That's the best kind of entertainment you can have, isn't it?
The best book you can read.
The best book you can read. The Bible. I've read a lot of different books, but I'm going to tell you, no book compares to this one, does it, Brother Tom?
That's right.
My favorite part of BBN is it comes on 2 o'clock, the Bible reading. Amen? That's the best part, isn't it? The Bible reading. The best part. You know, because you can listen to all kinds of stuff, music, and those things won't make you, they won't change your soul, they won't make you like Christ. But when you read His Word, they'll make you like the Lord, won't it? You gotta love the Lord. You gotta choose who you will serve, as Moses said. Who will you serve? For those who want to serve the Lord, come over here on my side. You know what happened? All the Levites came over to Moses, the tribe of Levi. And Moses says, now go, take your sword, go kill your brothers and your kindred who didn't come over here.
They killed it. Listen, was Moses sinful? Was Moses sinful?
He was a sinner, yeah, just like you and me.
What he said to those Levites, was he sinful?
But the Levite, you know what happened?
What?
Yeah. And he said, take your sword, and every man kill his brother who didn't come over here. killed about 3,000 men.
What?
3,000.
Why did Moses say that?
Well,
the Lord
must have instructed him to do that.
Not of the devil.
No, not of the devil. See, they didn't. The people that they killed, they didn't want to serve the Lord. And so Moses says, get them out of here. Because remember, Moses came down from the mount, and he didn't find, the people weren't, they didn't have a big party for Moses, saying, oh, Moses is back, Moses is back. Well, they were indulging in their sin, weren't they? He said, I sound, Joshua said, I hear the sound of people, but it's not the sound of war, it's the sound of people dancing. Well, my friend, we're going to close. But that's the point there, unconditional election. Salvation is a work of God, amen. Not of man. It's a work of God. And isn't that a good work, Brother Leroy?
It wasn't that.
Salvation's a good work of God.
That's right.
Nothing you can add to it.
Yeah.
The moment you start trying to take credit, at the moment you're off course.
Yeah.
Amen. All glory to God. You know what happened to King Herod Agrippa when he didn't give God the glory? Says his guts fell out. Right. How would you like that? Here he was giving this great speech.
Yeah.
And he didn't give God the glory.
Yeah.
And God took him out.
And one thing you don't want to change the Bible.
So well, you can.
Everything that's in the Bible is the truth.
Amen.
And don't add word and don't strike.
It don't take it away. Sir,
is it true that Moses lived 2,000 years before Jesus Christ?
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. That's pretty close. About 2,000 a year, yeah. 1900, something like that.
2,000.
Yeah, right around that time, John.
Yeah.
So, that's good. Let's go to God in a closing word of prayer, shall we? Let us pray. Our gracious, loving Heavenly Father, Father, we just thank you for choosing us before the foundations of the world. Thank you for placing us in Christ, giving us everlasting life, not because of any good thing in us, because Lord, you know there is no good thing in us. You are the only good thing in us and about us. And we thank you, praise you, we love you, we worship you. Lord, you know how often we fall, how short of your glory we come. But we're trusting in you, Lord, in your sovereign hand, your loving hand, your gracious hand, your hand of forgiveness. We pray, oh God, who has strengthened our faith and trust in you, you will continue to draw us closer to yourself. We'll clean our hands and we will purify our hearts by thy Spirit. You will build our house. Unless you build it, Lord, we're building in vain. Teach us, Lord, how to, whatever we do, do it unto you, not unto men. We pray for each person gathered here, Lord Tom, Herbert, Leroy, and John. Bring your hand of blessing, help, and strength upon us. Brother Chris, who didn't make it today. Oh, Father, please, with your hand of healing, we beseech you, help us, and Brother Tom, feel better. Oh, God, we need you. We can't do anything without you. We worship you and praise you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right.